Good evening.
Good evening.
Our lesson will launch from 1 Peter chapter 4. We'll launch from verses 16 and 17. 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 16 and 17. The Apostle Peter writing to exiles of the dispersion, some would say under the persecution of Nero. He's writing a letter to churches in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. There's persecution in the land, but he's writing to encourage the people, remain faithful to the Lord. He writes in verse 16 and 17, "Yet if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in this matter. For the time has come for judgment to begin at the house of God. And if it begin with us, what will be the end of those who do not obey the gospel of God?" Traveling from Sefner, I'm originally from Tampa, Florida. In order for me to get over here to Pinellas Park Church of Christ, I had to cross a bridge. There's a lot of water in between the shores of Tampa and St. Petersburg. So I had to cross a bridge. And in crossing the bridge, naturally it occurs to me that in order for me to cross this bridge, someone had to suffer in order to make it easy for a guy like me to cross the bridge and make it safely into the house of the Lord. Someone had to labor, someone had to toil, someone had to suffer. And that's as simple as I can put it when you think about the connection, when the suffering that took place that led to salvation. Someone had to suffer in order for us to enter the kingdom of heaven. And when we consider this idea, this concept of a bridge, the Bible tells us, Paul told Timothy that there is one God and there is one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. So we see the same way that I had to leave Tampa to get over here to Pinellas Park Church of Christ, that there was a bridge I had to cross. So naturally, for those who believe in God, in order for you to get to God, there had to be a bridge you had to cross. And Christ is that bridge. But there comes a time in the body where we begin to suffer for righteousness' sake. And there are times we have to be encouraged. Because the beautiful thing about being a Christian is 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 8 and 9. You know it. Peter tells them, "But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, who were once not a people, but are now the people of God, who had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy." That is the beautiful aspect we see about being a Christian. Because I don't know about you, but I don't come from royalty. And no one has ever told me that I was chosen for anything. And no one's ever told me that I was royal. And nobody ever told me that I was someone's special people. But according to the scriptures, Peter told these folks who were in Christ Jesus, that you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people. And why? What's your purpose? To proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into light. No, not into light, but into his marvelous light. There's a difference between called from darkness into light. You were called into his marvelous light. So Matthew 5 makes sense, right? "Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father, which is in heaven." So we weren't called from darkness into the light, but we were called into his marvelous light. That's the beautiful aspect of being a Christian. But in 1 Peter 2, just the same, and verse 21, he says, "For to this you were called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving an example that you may follow his steps." That's the perplexing aspect of being a Christian. Hold up. You told me that I was a royal priesthood. You told me I was a chosen generation. But now you're telling me that I have to suffer. But we go back to the original example. Someone had to suffer in order for me to simply cross a bridge. So the thesis this evening is everybody wants to be blessed, but nobody wants to suffer. But the truth is, you can't have one without the other. Everybody wants to be blessed and nobody wants to suffer. But the truth is, you can't have one without the other. The title of the lesson will be "Something to Consider While You Suffer." Something to consider while you suffer. There are a few things in particular that we need to consider. One, you're blessed. Two, you're beloved. Three, you're heaven bound. But finally, beware. One, we're blessed. Two, we are beloved. Three, we're heaven bound. But finally, beware. Let's go to 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 8 through 9. We'll do our best to spend a lot of time in the book of 1 Peter because we're dealing with the issue of suffering, but remaining faithful in suffering. And I hope that this lesson hits someone in the right place, because I don't know anybody's struggle here. I mean, this is the beautiful side of the bay. I mean, all we see this water and these palm trees. I don't know if anybody's suffering in St. Petersburg. I don't know. Yet and still, if you are a believer in Jesus Christ and you walk in righteousness, it would be very difficult for you not to be suffering. Because Paul said in Acts, 14:22, "It is through much tribulation that we must inherit the kingdom of God." 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 8 and 9. He writes, "Finally, all of you be of one mind, having compassion for one another." He says, "Love as brothers, be tenderhearted, be courteous, not returning evil for evil or reviling for reviling, but on the contrary, blessing, knowing that you were called to this, to inherit a blessing." Now, when we look at these verses, we realize that he says that we're blessed, but he doesn't tell us what the blessing is. That's because a lot of times we skip right to verse 9. But before we talk about what the blessing is and where the blessing is, the question is, are we of one mind? Are we compassionate for one another? Do we love as brothers? Are we tenderhearted toward one another? Are we courteous toward one another? Or are we returning evil for evil or reviling for reviling? Before we talk about a blessing, we have to talk about the stipulations placed on the blessing. Because how can I receive the blessing while we behave, if I'm behaving myself as mentioned in verse 8? But as it relates to the blessing, you know, in Matthew chapter 5, verses 3 through 12, what we call the Beatitudes. The Bible says that Jesus, seeing the multitudes, he went up on a mountain. And when he was seated, his disciples came to him. Then he opened his mouth and he began to teach them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Then he said, "Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted." Then he said, "Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth." Then he said, "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled." Then he said, "Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy." Then he said, "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Then he said, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. Then he said, blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. But in verse 11 and 12, he asks, blessed are you when men shall revile you and persecute you and say all manner of evil against you falsely for my name's sake. He said, rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. So to the question, what is the blessing and where is the blessing? That question is answered. Those questions are answered in Matthew 5, 3 through 12. But again, even Jesus hinted right back to this. You can rejoice and be exceedingly glad if you are persecuted for righteousness' sake. In 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 2, verses 12 through 16. 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 12 through 16. Excuse me, 12 through 15. He says, beloved, do not think it strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened to you. But rejoice to the extent that you partake of Christ's sufferings, that when his glory is revealed, you may also be glad with exceeding joy. If you are reproached for the name of Christ, blessed are you. If you are reproached for the name of Christ, blessed are you. For the Spirit of God, for the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. On their part, he is blasphemed. But on your part, he is glorified. But let none of you suffer as a murderer, a thief, an evildoer, or a busybody in other people's matters. He made it very plain. If you are reproached for the name of Christ, blessed are you. So we make it very simple and very plain. We are blessed when we suffer for Christ. But the unfortunate aspect is that sometimes, again, we want to be blessed without the suffering. So parents, me and my wife have 7 children, me and my wife, and we have 2 teenagers. And I don't know if any of you have raised teenagers, but teenagers desire for you to go to work all day while they eat everything in the refrigerator. Teenagers desire you to pay the cable bill while they watch all the channels. Teenagers desire you to make all the money and pay the cell phone bill. Teenagers desire you to pay for the vacation while they go on it. They have a misunderstanding about the concept that you must don't understand somebody had to work for the things that you eat. So the Lord is making it simple and plain for us. We can't have one without the other. But it is to the glory of God and to your own glory, when his glory is revealed, that you suffered for the cause of Christ. While everyone was enjoying their life, you were suffering for Christ. And for this, you will be blessed. That's point one, you're blessed. Point two, we are beloved. Let's look at 1 Peter chapter 2, and we'll look at verses 11 through 12. 1 Peter chapter 2, and we'll look at verses 11 and 12. Peter writes, beloved, I beg you as sojourners and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts which war against the soul, having your conduct honorable before the Gentiles, that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may, by your good deeds, glorify God. Sorry. They may, by your good deeds, which they observe, glorify God in the day of visitation. We'll deal with this one word first, beloved, because you notice there's a beloved and then there's a comma. Now, I don't know how this works with I used to teach a little bit of school. What was it? Dependent clauses and independent. This word here, beloved, right? There's something to follow, but it stops there for a reason. Because he wants you to know who you are in Christ. You remember in Matthew chapter 3 when Jesus came to John the Baptist to be baptized. And John the Baptist said, you come to me to be baptized, but I have need to be baptized by you. But Jesus says, suffer it to be so now that we may fulfill all righteousness. And when he went down in the water, he came up immediately. The Bible says that the heavens opened to him. And he saw the Holy Spirit descending upon him like a dove. But then God himself was involved too. Because this is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. So God himself referred to his only begotten son as beloved. In Ephesians chapter 1 verses 3 through 6, Paul writing to the church at Ephesus says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ. Just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ to himself, according to his good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, by which he made us accepted in the beloved. So we see that God refers to his own son as beloved. And the apostle Paul refers and tells those Christians at Ephesus that we were made accepted in the beloved. So it follows logically that we are his beloved. If A equals B and B equals C, you know that A equals C. If God said Jesus is the beloved, and Paul said we were made accepted in the beloved, then obviously we are his beloved. That we must know. But because we are his beloved, there are some things that he wants us to know. He says, I beg you, as sojourners and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts which war against the soul. He said, I beg you, as sojourners and pilgrims. Naturally, this implies, or this we infer, that this is not our home. He wants those who are scattered abroad in this particular era to understand that I understand the trials that you are going through. But count it all joy, because this is not our home. For our citizenship is in heaven. So don't consider it a strange thing as it relates to the trial, the fiery trial that has come to test you. Somewhere he talked about that the genuineness of your faith may be made known. So we're beloved, but there are some things that we have to go through naturally. And he makes it very clear that we have to abstain from fleshly lusts which war against the soul. Now, I don't know about you, but I've never seen a pimp. I've never physically seen a pimp. But I've never seen or heard of a pimp who was referred to as the father of the year. Have you ever heard of a pimp referred to as the father of the year? Have you ever heard of a prostitute referred to as the mother of the year or a virtuous wife? So if you've never heard of a pimp referred to as the father of the year and a prostitute referred to as a virtuous wife, then how do you think it looks to those in the world that we call ourselves Christians, but we partake in every fleshly lust that the world partakes in? The same way it doesn't look appropriate, it doesn't look appropriate on us. The same way Michael Jordan didn't look right playing baseball. The same way Michael Phelps didn't look right when he retired from swimming. But notice both of those men, they had a moment when they lost their love, it seems, for the sport that they were involved in. But somewhere they came to their senses and they returned. And they continued as the champions that they were. From my understanding, Michael Phelps won another 5 gold medals this past Olympics. Michael Jordan had 3 three-peats, retired, came back and won another 3-peat. The same thing with us. There are times when we fall astray and we suffer and we're persecuted and we begin to wonder, where is God in all of this? And in the process of suffering, some of us say, God is not with me, and we attempt to return to the old lifestyle, the old habits, the things that made me comfortable, casual drinking and casual partying with friends. It shall not be for God's people. He finishes this verse by saying that by observing your good works, he says that they will glorify God in a day of visitation, which implies there is a day of visitation. Now, he doesn't specify whether it's going to be judgment day. He doesn't specify whether it's going to be a day when God shows up through the Holy Spirit to test those who tested God's people. But there will be a day of visitation. You remember in 1 Kings 3, when those two harlots came before Solomon, and one of those harlots said, hey, this woman, in the middle of the night, she laid on her child. And when her child died, she came and replaced my living child with her dead child. And when I rose in the morning to feed my child, there lay this dead child. So they had this dispute back and forth before King Solomon. The other one said, no, the living child is mine and the dead child is yours. So Solomon said, bring me a sword. Bring me a sword. Because you say this and you say this. Bring me a sword. Cut the child in half. Give half to this woman and half to this woman. He says that the mother of the child said, no, don't harm the child. Let the child live. But the woman who was not the mother said, well, no, don't let either one of us have the child. Take the life of the child. Neither one of us should have it. And Solomon said, give the child to the first woman, for she is the mother. All of that to say this, the world plays all these types of games or attempts to play these games on God's people. And they say, no, we have the true doctrine. You have the false doctrine. We're the true believers. You guys are foolish for believing in a fallacy in Santa Claus. And they attempt to switch doctrines and say that you have the dead doctrine and we have the living doctrine. And they attempt to take this lie before God. But just like Solomon in the day of visitation, he's going to make a separation. Goats over here, sheep over here, wheat over here, tares over here. He's going to make it very plain and make it known your righteousness. And if Solomon had that kind of wisdom, you better believe that God has that kind of wisdom to make the righteousness of his people known. You're blessed, you're beloved, you're heaven bound. Let's look at 1 Peter chapter 1, and we'll look at verses 3 through 5. 1 Peter chapter 1, and we're looking at verses 3 through 5. The Apostle Peter writes, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. He said, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled and that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Notice he says, first, he mentions in here that we've been begotten again. You remember in John chapter 3 when Nicodemus came to Jesus by night. And for whatever reason he came to Jesus, we don't know. The Bible doesn't exactly tell us. But we do know that he was a Pharisee. He was a man of the law. But he came by night to Jesus and he had these questions and concerns about this or that. But he had all these little pleasantries he attempted to approach Jesus with and saying, you must be, we know that you are a teacher come from God because nobody can do these miracles. But Jesus cut him right off. And he says, verily, verily, I say unto you, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. And Jesus has a way of going about making statements which bring out the ignorance or the foolishness in people. And he said, well, how can a man be born again when he is old? Can he enter into his mother's womb again and be born again? But Jesus had to clarify for him. He said, verily, verily, I say unto you, except a man be born of the water and of the spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. Now, notice in verse 3, he says, if he is not baptized, if he isn't born again, he can't see it. But then he says, if he is not born again of the water and of the spirit, he can't enter it. We are heaven bound because we have actually entered the kingdom of heaven. I believe it's Colossians 1:13 when he says we've been translated from darkness into the kingdom of the Son of his love. So everybody said, well, why are we still on earth? That doesn't mean we're not still seated in heavenly places. He said, all we've been blessed with all spiritual places in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus. We've been seated in the heavenly places in Christ. But I'm wondering, what about this mortal flesh? In due time, it must be put off. But for those who have not been baptized into Jesus, he makes it very clear. You cannot enter unless you are born again of the water and of the spirit. Then he says, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that does not fade away. But he said it's reserved in heaven for you. But it's incorruptible and it's undefiled and it doesn't fade away. Which implies everything that's not in heaven must be corruptible, must be defiled, and it must fade away. So somewhere he told us, do not lay up for yourself treasures on earth, but lay up for yourself treasures in heaven. So he makes it very clear, it's stored up in heaven. But let's take a look at heaven, because I like the idea of that. Because some people say, heaven is a good idea, but I mean, are we really going to walk on streets of gold? Are we really going to stand before God? Are we really going to be in the presence of God for eternity? My answer is yes. And the Bible confirms in Revelation 21. We'll look at verses 1-4, then we'll look at verses 7 and 8. Revelation 21, 1-4, he says, now I saw a new heaven. This is John the Revelator writing the Apostle John. He says, now I saw a new heaven and a new earth. There it is right there. A new heaven and a new earth. He says, for the first heaven and the first earth have passed away. Also, there was no more sea. Then I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people. God himself will be with them and be their God. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away. So remember, the Apostle Peter is writing this letter to saints who are being persecuted. But John is making it clear and known to God's people today, there will come a time when all those things will pass away. There will be no more sorrow. There will be no more pain. But he acknowledges for a time, we have to suffer through those things for a season. In verse 7 and verse 8, he who overcomes shall inherit all things. And I will be his God, and he shall be my son. But the cowardly, unbelieving, abominable, murderers, sexually immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars shall have their part in a lake which burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. Now, some people say, preacher, you shouldn't preach on hell. I wasn't trying to preach on hell. Neither was John. John was talking about a new heaven and a new earth. But in the process of this revelation that he's receiving from Christ, somewhere Christ told him to put those words down. Because it must be understood that as a Christian, we must suffer. But for those who attempt to revert back to an old lifestyle of sexual immorality and idolatry and lying and sorcery and all these other things, he says, it cannot be mentioned among God's people. It cannot be mentioned among God's people because none of these things and none who partake in these things will inherit the kingdom of heaven. But notice he says in 1 Peter 3 through 5, he says, who were kept by the power of God. So he lets us know you can't do it yourself. Then he says, through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Through faith, you know, Hebrews 11:6, for without faith, it is impossible to please God. For he who comes to him must believe that he is and a rewarder of him who diligently seek him. He said, without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him, diligently seek him, diligently seek him. Did anybody see this past Super Bowl? Don't raise your hands too high. I know we can't. I get it. That's one of those things that will pass away. I get it. But you remember in this game, the Patriots were down 25 points in this game. And everybody said, it's over. There's no way. No one has ever come back in a Super Bowl from a deficit that large. There's no way that they can win the championship now. It's over. Brady, good try. But it seems like Brady went into a zone. And he began to drop back and simply deliver the passes. And he dropped back and delivered every pass. And he dropped back and delivered each pass. He just kept dropping back and delivering the passes. And slowly but surely, they begin to chip away at this lead. They're scoring points and the other team is not scoring. They're scoring points and the other team is not scoring. But you can tell on the other side of the field, they had gotten comfortable. They had a 25-point lead, so they thought that it was all over. We have the victory. Little did they know that this guy seeking his fifth Super Bowl championship was going to keep delivering the pass, delivering the pass, delivering the pass. And they took that lead away from them. They went to overtime and they walked away Super Bowl champions. I said all that to say this. In this world that we live in, it looks like everyone is winning. It looks like the world is winning. They're in the lead. Oh, look at them. They're praising their God and they're going to church every Sunday. They go in the morning. They go in the evening. Oh, what a mundane life. It looks like everyone is winning. But you and I both know if we keep stepping back and we keep praising God and we keep stepping back and we keep sharing the love of Jesus and we keep stepping back and we keep delivering the word of God, in due time, the victory will be ours. But even that notion cannot adequately apply because Jesus said, I've already overcome the world. We already have the victory. You're blessed. You're beloved. You're heaven bound. But finally, beware. In 1 Peter chapter 5, Peter writes to these saints in verse 8, 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8. He writes, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks around like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. When I go to school in the morning at a Florida School of Preaching, it takes me 30 minutes. I go I-4 30 minutes east. And naturally coming home, I go I-4 30 minutes west to get back home. And along the I-4 corridor, you see all this greenery. You see strawberry patches. You see pastures. And I noticed one day in coming home, I noticed that the greener the pasture, the fatter the cows. I noticed this with my own eyes. I mean, I grew up in Tampa, Florida. I don't know anything about agriculture or any of that stuff. But I simply noticed in driving down I-4, the grass pastures or lands or whatever that were kind of sun bleached, sun beaten, that the cows were a little smaller. But when I got to saw the greener pasture, those cows were actually a little fatter. And it came to me, two forms of a concept, one positive, one negative. The positive thing is this, man, God provides green pastures for his people. Now, we're not cows, but you remember what David said in Psalms 23. He says, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. This is David telling us this. So I said, man, this is the way God takes care of his people. But then the other part of the concept came to me and I said, imagine if a wild lion was dropped along the I-4 corridor. I mean, these lions are, these cows are just out here grazing without a care. And if someone drops a wild lion on the I-4 corridor, what will they do? Because that lion will feast for all of his days. Unless they call somebody and say, man, we got a lion out here on I-4. He is going to eat lovely. But then I started thinking about the church. If a lion walked through that door right now, all of us would scatter. And some of us may be a little faster than others, and we may be able to make it out these side doors. And husbands, hopefully you don't leave your wives behind, and fathers, hopefully you don't leave your children behind. But at the end of the day, that's a lion. What, are you going to stand there and try to pet it? It's funny, but you know what? That's exactly what people are doing with sin. They're assuming that the world is a petting zoo. And that all of these sins are just little pets. I know for us in Tampa, we have Laurie Park Zoo and we have Busch Gardens. All these little, you know, fornication and adultery and all these things that we just pet and play with. But the Lord said, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks around like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. I've never met a sin that doesn't bite. The Lord is teaching us, do not play with sin. I close by saying this. My wife doesn't play around when it's time to go. And sometimes our kids, they like to, oh, mama, wait, let me go in the house and grab my game station or this little iPad or something. But she has to go. She's trying to get somewhere. So two of my sons this afternoon, she said, I need to go to my mom's house to do something. But two of the boys, my oldest son and my third son, mama, let me run in the house and get something real quick. And she pulled off on them. And I was supposed to be taking a little nap, because I had to preach early that morning at Lower Street Church of Christ. So I wanted to get in a little nap before I came over to Pinellas Park. And I come out the door. I'm like, what are you guys still standing here for? And they said, mama left us. And I asked one of my boys, he was the younger boy. He was crying because she was kind of playing a game on him. She was only going to get gas and come right back. But she played a game. They thought she was gone. And my younger boy was crying. I was like, son, that'll teach you something. When mama said it's time to go, It's time to go. You don't have time to go back in the house to get something. And then I asked my oldest son, I was like, well, what do you think about that? And he said about his young, he said, she should have left him. My oldest son saying that she should have left him. And then he was like, well, she shouldn't have left me. And I said, well, you didn't think mama would leave you? He said, no, I didn't think she would leave me. This is the firstborn son. And then it hit me again. You know, there are some of us who think God is playing when he says he's coming back for a church that's undefiled, without spot, without blemish. And everybody is trying to go, and some of us, we get caught up. I want to go get another degree real quick before I serve the Lord. Somebody in the Bible said, let me go and bury my father real quick before I serve the Lord. The other one said, let me go and close out this business. Let me go take care of some business before I serve the Lord. Just like my sons who were left behind by their mother, that is exactly what God is going to do to those who decide that they have something else they need to do other than serve the Lord. When the Lord said it's time to go, it's time to go. You are either in the vehicle or you're not. And in this same book, I believe Peter said there is now a vessel that now saves, an antitype, which is baptism. He says, not the removal of the filth of the flesh, but the answer of a good conscience toward God. We want to have a good conscience toward God so we don't have time to play with sin, to pet sin, or we don't have time to go and get something else. We need to continue serving steadfast in the faith, serving the Lord. The message is yours. I don't know if anyone desires to be baptized. The water is ready. If you desire to ask prayer or make a confession, I'm sure the brothers will help you with that. Praise God.